So let me say a few things about the genesis of this talk or how it began. I was working on my first book, Pluralist Universalism, and I was studying this author, Alex Cole. You know, he has a very strange life and born in Boston, but raised partially in China and then came to back to the US. And I found a very interesting pattern in all his writings. He tends to juxtapose or bring together Native American history and the experiences of ethnic minorities in China to make certain points. And so I follow through with that pattern and I studied this issue more closely. I studied the connections, right, between ethnic relations and ethnic policies in contemporary China and in the contemporary US more closely and more broadly in my book project. So this talk is comes partially from the book, but also I have some new material thrown in that's not included in the book. All right, so that's the genesis of this talk. All right. So the focus of this talk is two Chinese American writers, Alex Cole and Aku Wuwu. And I'm defining the category of Chinese American writing broadly, and I'll say more about how I think about how I approach this idea. So I'm trying to see the ways in which Chinese American writing mediates between two very different structures, two different very disparate contexts, right? Ethnic relations in China and ethnic relations or notions of race and indigeneity and ethnicity in the US in the contemporary period, in the post-Cold War era. So that's sort of the focus of my talk. And that's how I understand the title, right? Chinese and Native American connections. I'm looking at these connections through the lens of Chinese American writing. I'm trying to make an argument about the role that Chinese American writing plays in mediating between these two contexts. So that's the major point that I'm trying to make today. But I'm going to start with two examples of direct connections between Chinese Americans and Native Americans, right? So what I'm going to start with is not part of my main topic, but I think it's good to start with something more intuitive and more easier to understand, meaning direct contact or direct connections between Chinese American writing, Chinese American experiences, and Native American history. All right. So the first example I'm going to use is a pair of writers from the turn of the 20th century, from the very beginning of the 20th century. And so one is Zikala Shah, a Sioux woman and musician who is one of the earliest female writers to write literarily about, in English, about Native American experience. So of course the other writer is Susan Farr, right, which is the pen name for Edith Eden, right, a Eurasian writer from the turn of the 20th century, who is the first woman writer to write in English about the Chinese American experience, right? So the first example is a comparison or a juxtaposition between these two writers. Okay, so Zikala Shah, born on the reservation, a Sioux reservation, but educated outside of her reservation. So she went to a vocational institute and later on went on to college. Right. So this is a memoir that she published in 1900 in the Atlantic. Right. This is a memoir about her college days. What happened during her time in college. Now this is. From this excerpt here is from chapter 7 of her memoir, which is titled "Incurring My Mother's Displeasure." So this is a chapter about her participation in an intramural oratory contest, and she wins this contest. So she has this moment of exhilaration, but then right afterwards she experiences the pain of guilt and poignance right after her winning this contest. So this is the end of this chapter where she talks about this negative feeling that she's experiencing. She says, leaving the crowd as quickly as possible, I was soon in my room. The rest of the night, I sat in an armchair and gazed into the crackling fire. I laughed no more in triumph, but thus alone. The little taste of victory did not satisfy a hunger in my heart. In my mind, I saw my mother far away on the western plains, and she was holding a charge against me. Now, what she's saying that she, you know, she has chosen to attend college against the will of her mother. So she's feeling guilty for having betrayed her own culture, her own family, for having sort of, you know, left the reservation for assimilation into white civilization, right? So this is really a moment where you know, Sikh Kalesha talks about the consequence or the cost of assimilation, right? The how assimilation comes at the expense of the organic family structure and traditional tribal communities, the integrity of traditional tribal communities. So let's take a look at a story by Susan Farr from her collection, 1912 collection, Mrs. Brin Fragrances. Right, the title of the story is In the Land of the Free. The story is basically about a Chinatown couple, you know, who have managed to naturalize as American citizens. We know that, you know, if you know something about early Chinese American history, we know that, you know, the period between 1882 and 1943, right, is a period of Chinese exclusion, right? So during this period, the Chinese were not allowed to enter the U.S. or naturalize as American citizens. But for various reasons, some Chinese did manage to become American citizens, you know, for accidental and or by virtue of, you know, different kinds of maneuverings. Some Chinese immigrants did manage to become citizens at the time. And so this is a Chinatown couple who are American citizens, but they go back to China to pick up their son, and they try to bring back their son to the U.S., to America, to reunite with themselves. But as they carry their son across the border, the son is detained, is stopped by a customs officer because the son doesn't have proper documentation to prove that he is really genuinely a biological son to this couple. So the customs officer takes away the son and puts him in the mission, so the couple don't get to see the son until 10 months later, right? So this is the end of the story where the mother finally gets reunited with the son after the 10 months. And again, this is a moment of a great poignance that sort of recalls, for me, recalls the passage from Sikh Kalesha. All right, so she, that this referring to a nun in the mission, right? So she is, the nun is going to get the fetch the boy for the mother. So she withdrew for a moment, it seemed like an hour to the mother, then she reappeared, leading by the hand a little boy dressed in blue cotton overalls and white soled shoes. The little boy's face was round and dimpled, and his eyes were very bright. "Little one, ah, my little one," cried Lea Chu. She fell on her knees and stretched her hungry arms toward her son. But the little one shrunk from her mother and tried to hide himself in the folds of the white woman's skirt. "Go away, go away," he bade his mother. Now, I was struck by the word hungry, right? So remember that hunger, the word hunger in the previous passage. So here again, you know, the mother is hungry for the affection of the boy, and yet, you know, and yet this affection and her affection for the son is not returned. So again, so what we see here is how immigration, right, you know, coming to the U.S., for, you know, the couple, they naturalizing as American citizens, coming and immigrating to the U.S., also exacts a kind of cost from this couple, right? And this cost is similar to what we saw in the previous passage written by Sikh Kalesha. Again, the family is torn apart, right? The son refuses to acknowledge the mother. The affection between the son and the mother is torn asunder. And this is, again, this is shown in the story or explicitly suggested in the story as a consequence of immigration regulations, right? So immigrants, they have to, especially, you know, aspiring immigrants from China during this period, they have to prove beyond any reasonable doubt that they're really biologically related to American citizens in order for them to, you know, to be allowed into the country and to be, you know, accepted into the fold of American citizenship. And so what we see here in the two passages is that assimilation and Chinese exclusion, right? These seem to be two opposing historical processes, right? Assimilation is about forcing a group into, or integrating a group forcefully into, right, American citizenship. And exclusion is about pushing a people away from citizenship. And yet, these two opposite processes experienced by Native Americans and Chinese Americans respectively, in fact, produce very similar psyche consequences and social percussions, right? Also produce very similar effects on the basic family unit in both these communities. So this is the first example that I want to show you, right? So this shows you the kind of unexpected parallel between Chinese American and Native American writings from the early 20th century. Now, the second example is much more recent. This is from Karen Tae Yamashita, her most recent novel, I, Hotel, which came out in 2011. And this is a long, epic novel where Yamashita chronicles the various events that took place that constituted the emergence of the Asian American movement, and she covers the ten year span between 1968 and 1978, right? So this is a book documenting or chronicling the emergence of the Asian American movement, and in the 1973 chapter, so each of her chapters covers one of the 10 years, right? So she has a chapter on 1973 called International Hotel. And so this is an excerpt from this chapter. The scenario described in this chapter, in this excerpt, is this. So a group of Asian Americans, they're trying to cross the San Francisco Bay to get to this island called the Alcatraz Island in the middle of the bay. And so they're trying to go there because they're trying to reenact the occupation of the island, which actually took place in 1969 to 1971. So a student Indian group, in fact, occupied the island, right, for the length of 18 months. And this group of Asians, they're trying to reenact and restage this act of protest, restage, right, this act of occupation. Okay, so this is the excerpt. A group self-identified by their Asian features gathered at Pier 30, 9 under a full November moon, dancing through the usual lace of San Francisco Bay fog. Of course, depending, they could have been mistaken for Indian. It wouldn't be the first time someone recognized the features that claimed the same genes that crossed the Bering Strait or canoed across the Pacific. Different tribes is all, right? So what this, what Yamashita is saying is that, first of all, those Asians are trying to show solidarity, right, with the Indians by virtually participating and retroactively participating in their activism. So they're trying to take and occupy the island in the footsteps of this Indian student group. But the author is saying that this moment of solidarity, in fact, is sustained by deeper connections, by more historical connections. The Indians, in fact, the Native Americans are said to have migrated, right, tens of thousands of years ago from Eurasia through the land bridge of Beringia. So there is this deep genealogical historical connection and actual connection between Native Americans and Asians. So of course, this can be seen as a historical myth, or it's just a way of construing an origin for Native Americans. But this is Yamashita's way of saying is that this is her way of saying, or this is her way of recuperating a historical moment for us when Asian American activists were actively trying to build alliances and show solidarity with Native Americans, with Indians. All right, okay. So these are the two examples. Now moving on to my main topic, which is the contribution that the Chinese American writing makes, right, to bringing together, to bridging and linking to very disparate contexts and histories. Now before that, I have to explain to you in more detail how I understand, how I approach the concept of Chinese American writing, because the two authors I discuss here, the two main authors I discuss here, they're not often talked about as Chinese American writers, right? They're not as heavily anthologized as some of the other more familiar names like Kingston or Frank Chin. And so they really allow me, and they force critics, including me, to put pressure on how we conventionally understand Chinese American writing, right? So they force me to broaden and to rethink how I define this term. Now, there are a few criteria that people normally use to understand and to define to describe and to judge a piece of writing as Chinese American. Now, first of all, identity of the author, right? So we often say that if a literary text is produced by an American of Asian descent who has spent most of his or her life in the U.S. and speaks and writes English, then this counts as a piece of Chinese American literature or Chinese American writing. And the second often used criterion is themes, right? So we look at whether a piece of writing engages the theme of racialization, right? The racialization of Asians in America, or the theme of immigrant consciousness, how immigrants remember reimagine the homeland, right? So these are themes we commonly associate with Chinese American writing as well as other categories of Asian American writing. But I believe that these two categories are tend to be somewhat exclusionary in certain cases. And this is not, I'm not the first person to point this out, and many other critics have argued similar things, right? So, it's a little too narrow to include only English language writers, right, within the perimeters of Chinese American writing, because there are many sort of Chinese visitors, Chinese immigrants, Chinese students who come here and continue to write in Chinese. So that's something that we need to take account of by stretching this concept a little bit more. And the same goes with themes, right? So there are books written by Chinese Americans who have perhaps very little to do with some of the common themes, right? A book like, for example, the Battle Hymn of the Tiger Mother, right? Written by Amy Chua, a notable Chinese American, but clearly, this kind of writing, it's hard to include this book in a more narrow understanding of Chinese American writing. I'm not endorsing this book. I'm not a fan of this book. I'm just saying that these two, the commonly used criteria, could be a little exclusionary. I believe that there is something else that we need to consider when we think about whether something is Chinese American. I believe that the tone of voice or the rhetorical disposition of the writing is also important. In other words, we can't really define what is Chinese American writing positively, right, in positive terms. We can perhaps only say that what may or may not be Chinese American. In other words, I believe that Chinese American literature is marked precisely by a kind of indeterminacy, by a kind of built-in ambiguity about where it belongs. About where it belongs in terms of literary traditions, canons, and cultural spheres, right? So it's very difficult to understand, it's sometimes very difficult to place a piece of writing. And this indeterminacy, this kind of ambiguity, perhaps is precisely what marks a piece of writing as Chinese American writing. I believe that Chinese American writing is inherently transnational, comparative, and indeterminate. It's hard to place any Chinese American writing squarely within a tradition, a literary tradition, or a framework of a cultural framework. So this kind of rethinking is precisely what my writers allowed me and forced me to do. Okay, so the first writer today, Alex Kuo, and this is a recent picture of his taken from his website. So if you just type Alex Kuo, the first thing that comes up in the search page is his personal website. So you can definitely go check out his website if after the talk if you're interested. Okay, let me just say a few things about his life. And I mentioned earlier, right? So he was born here in the U.S. in Boston. His father was Chinese. His father was a Chinese. It was one of the earliest Chinese psychologists. So he was studying and work in the U.S. off and on, you know, for a long period. So he was born here, but then he went back with his family, and so grew up there. You know, spent his teenage years, or you know. His young adulthood, I guess, in China, in various parts of China, in Chongqing, and then Shanghai, and then Hong Kong. And he returned to the U.S. to go to high school and college. He later on received an MFA from Iowa's from Iowa Writers' Workshop. And since then he has been he has held a number of teaching positions at various institutions, and until quite recently he had been teaching in the Department of English and Comparative American Comparative American Cultures at Washington State University. All right, so he can be called he can be described as a poet scholar, you know. So he has had an academic career as well as a literary one. All right, so I have a list of his major works. So he started publishing in 1971. As you can, you know, he started out as a poet. So he started publishing in 1971. The Window Tree, his first collection of poetry. And then 1974, 1986, 1999, and then starting around 1989, a very important year in contemporary Chinese history. But starting from 1989. Alex Kuo started lecturing visiting at various Chinese universities, right, in Shanghai, in Beijing, in Changchun, a city in the northeastern part of China, and as well as in Hong Kong. You know, so he started getting more immersed in contemporary Chinese culture, in 1989. And his first visit as a lecturer in China coincided with the eve of the 1989 student movement, right? So he was there just in the nick, just in time to witness this historical moment in China. And so his experiences in China apparently inspired a number of stories and a number of narrative works. Okay, so here's the Chinese opera, right? So his first novel. His novels are never really novels, and I'll explain why. But Chinese opera is sort of his first novel based on drawing upon his experiences in China. He in fact drafted this while he was teaching in China, around 1989, 1990. But it wasn't published until later, and Panda Diaries came out after that, 2006. White Jade and Other Stories is largely autobiographical. It's based on his family history. The Man Who Dammed the Yangtze, and Panda Diaries and The Man Who Dammed the Yangtze, they're seen as by the author, they're seen as the first two parts of a trilogy. So they have some sort of continuity between them. And he won Alex Kuo, he won an American Book Award, in I think around 2002. But still, his name doesn't have this, has that much visibility, right, among Chinese Americans or the general American. Public, and there are many reasons for that. And his writings don't fit very well, I suppose, into how we conventionally think about Chinese American writing. And in fact, an interesting sort of an anecdote is that when Alex Kuo was studying at Iowa Writers' Workshop, right, in the early 1970s. In the early 1960s. So he graduated there in 1963. But when he was there, he crossed paths with some big names. He he crossed paths with Frank Chin, who was also studying there, studying drama, right? The State University of Iowa, or you know, some nearby institution. So he crossed paths with Frank Chin, and also with Lawson Inada, who was also sort of this Japanese American poet who was also studying at the Iowa Writers' Workshop. So he was mingling. I mean, he knew very well those writers who later on who went on to put together this first anthology of Asian American literature, IEE, in 1974. Right. So you might have heard of some of you might have heard of this IEE anthology, right? But this IE anthology, if you read it, and also the later on the expanded version that came out in 1991, right, the big IE, both of these books, neither of these books includes Alex Kuo, so that's interesting, right? So he knew them, he knew those writers, the editors personally, and he was starting his literary career around the same time as those writers, and yet they didn't seem to be on that great terms, right? I was talking to Alex Kuo when I was interviewing him in 2005, and so he was saying that there was a misunderstanding, right? His aesthetics, first of all, in his first collection of poems, largely modernist poems, and so his aesthetics might not jive with theirs very well. And also, they thought of him, in protesting the Vietnam War, he wrote articles and adopted a pen name, which sounds like a white name. I think he called himself Mullick, and that's sort of the last name that he gave his. I can't remember the first name that he created for himself, but this the pen name that he made up for himself sounds like a white name. So he sort of perhaps struck a wrong chord with the other Chinese American writers at the time, and they thought of him as somewhat of a traitor. But this anecdote is simply reflective of a larger tension, right? A larger tension between. Between an activist, perhaps a more conventional and 1970s understanding of Chinese American writing, and how we might be able to broaden this concept today. What he has done right in both his poetry and in his fiction, narrative fiction, it's very important. It's very important to us thinking through certain. Central issues in Chinese American writing, especially, he helps us, think about how Chinese American writing is transnational. In what senses, right? In what senses is Chinese American writing transnational? What kind of connective functions does Chinese American writing have? So he does help us think about this issue deeply. All right, let me just go on to discuss a few tactics or sort of a few sort of techniques and tactics that Kuo sort of uses throughout his, especially his narrative works, right, to bridge different contexts and histories. Now, the first thing is rewriting or translation. Now, this example, and you can see this is from a collection of his short stories, titled Lipstick. So if you look at the right-hand column here, this is an excerpt from a story collected in this collection called Lipstick. Now the story is called Smoke. And the story has really no explicit references to American history, let alone Native American history. But if you read the whole story, then it becomes clear to you that the structure and the plot of the story, and also its structure, is very much based upon this poem written by Joy Harjo. This well anthologized poem, "Women Hanging from the 13th Floor Window." So Alex Kuo is essentially rewriting this poem as a story. Okay, so let me just show you this. On the left hand side, right? This is an excerpt from Joy Harjo's poem. Joy Harjo, of course. They are friends. I mean, they're friends in real life. Where Kuo and Harjo, they're real friends in real life. And this Harjo's poem is this woman, right? This woman in the poem is identified as a Creek woman, right? So this poem is about this Creek woman hanging from the 13th floor, trying to decide. whether to jump or not, or come back up. Right. So this is a poem about, you know, the various things that flash across this Creek woman's mind as she hangs from the 13th floor window, and what she ends up doing is left unresolved at the end of the poem. So we really don't know, right? So there is a moment of openness at the end of Joy Harjo's poem. And if you read the story and Smoke, and you realize that very similar things are going on in the story, but this whole context is moved and shifted to China, right? So this you know, this could adapt there. So Kuo adapts this poem and transplants the. And into a Chinese context. Now, what happens in the story is a Chinese woman is hanging from the 13th floor of the building of the Bank of China. So she is hanging to her dear life, and there is of course a team of policemen as well as psychologists, and you're trying to help her, trying to save her, trying to persuade her to come down or come back up. So there is this very short conversation between this woman and the psychologist, right, who is called to the scene to save this woman. Now the woman tells the psychologist, "Don't you want to hear why I'm here? Why I'm here trying to end my life?" A psychologist says, "Yes, of course, but would you come back up if I listened?" There was a slight sigh as if the wind had carried up from the Creek women with the saxophone case. Then she added, "If I do, will you trade places with me?" Now, at the end of the story, of course, Kuo is tipping his hat to Joy Harjo, right, by referring to Creek women. So he is recluing us, he's keying the readers in, right, to what he is doing. Though, so he's reminding us that he is, you know, rewriting or loosely translating Joy Harjo's poem. What you can see here, and a number of things are going on. First of all, the 13th floor is oftentimes or is sometimes missing in certain buildings, right? So many buildings don't have a 13th floor. So what both pieces seem to be saying is that, you know, Native Americans or Creek, the Creek tribe, and certain social groups in China, they're really invisible, right? So even when they're hanging from the 13th floor, an often non-existing space, right? So there are certain social groups in both national contexts that are invisible, and their calls for help, their cries for help are often not heard. So you know, having their voices heard, right, is a main issue, a central issue in both of these pieces, right? So that's why this woman here, she is willing to tell her stories, and she's asking the psychologist to hear her out. So both pieces are really about you know, having the subordinated, the marginalized voices, having those voices come out, right? So articulate the invisible pain and the invisible struggles of certain marginalized and social groups in both these contexts, and bringing those voices, unheard voices, out. But the interesting twist, right, that Alex Kuo sort of puts on his story at the end, is this the question of whether you can trade places with me, right? So this is a woman's question for the psychologist, and so here you might read this ending as the author's, as Kuo's way of referring to the reasons why he chose to base this whole story on the structure and themes of a Joy Harjo poem, right? So he is essentially trading places with Joy Harjo, right? So he is saying, you know, he's alerting us at the end of this story, he's alerting us to the importance of trading places, right? So hearing the voices of the other is not sufficient, or is not good enough, right? So this is only a first step, which should lead to something deeper, a deeper kind of empathy, which is not simply listening, right? This deeper kind of empathy, which involves more than listening. which should extend to trading places. So perhaps, you know, perhaps this is Alex Kuo's way of explaining why reading, you know, why it is, you know, if, of course it is not enough, but it's important though and not enough, right? It's not enough for different minority groups, for different sort of minority writers to simply to hear each other out or to read each other's writing. It's equally or perhaps more important to try to trade places with one another, to try to adopt each other's themes and rewrite those themes in one's own context, right? So trading places might be a way, might be a more effective way of building a more sustainable kind of cultural and political coalition among you know, different minority groups. So that's rewriting. All right, and another kind of pattern, another kind of tactic that I often see in Kuo is double writing. And what I mean by double writing is that he often sort of just brings together or sort of loosely juxtaposes two sets of references or two, you know, two different histories, two different contexts, without suggesting that there is exact so correspondence or equivalence between these two between these two sets of references, but he simply puts them together, brings them together, to imply certain nebulous and indeterminate connections and similarities, without specifying, you know, what exactly those connections are, without saying that these situations are identical or completely completely similar. But double writing is a way of evoking, right? Is a kind of loose association that evokes. Thoughts about connections, connections and similarities, without imposing a very rigid sort of, you know, a rigid relationship between what's being compared and connected. All right, so this is an excerpt from Chinese Opera, right? This novel that he published in 2001, and in fact, his novels they don't really adhere to, you know, the conventions of novels. What you see often from him is sort of a crossbreed between a novel and a set of short stories. So his novels are often written as his novels often read as if They were compilations of a set of short stories, an ensemble of short stories, and that's why they you can't really find a tight sort of knit plot, right, in most of his novels. He would tell a story, but at the same time he would disrupt his own narrative. He would disrupt his own story with random things, you know, with new stories, with just snippets of Chinese history and American history. So he would do all sorts of things to disrupt our sense of a continuous and close tight-knit plot. All right, so in any case, so this is a passage from his 2001 novel Chinese Opera, and this is to tell you a bit about the plot of this book, right? So Chinese Opera is about this American couple, and the husband is Chinese American and the wife is half black and half Native American. So this American couple visit China to perform. You know, the husband is Sonny Lin. That's his name, Sonny Lin. So he is a musician, a teacher, and the wife is a performer as well. So they move to this China, visit China on the eve of the 1969 student movement. So they, you know, they witness this historical moment, and they even help certain dissident intellectuals in China sort of escape Chinese boundaries. So this is a passage about, you know, how they play a role, how this American couple play a role in helping the escape of a dissident intellectual teaching at Tsinghua University. All right, so let me just read this excerpt for you. These intellectuals in Beijing suburbs engaged in fomenting these subversive activities. were being investigated. Many arrests have been made. Some of these intellectuals' photographs have appeared on CCTV. Citizens have been asked to report their whereabouts to the nearest PSB office, the Public Security Bureau office. It has often been reported that the foreigner disguised as a Uyghur or Tibetan compatriot has been seen helping some mathematics or physics professor from Tsinghua University disappear before the PSB could locate him. Now, this is, of course, you know, the narrator relating a news report, right? The narrator relating a news report for us. And here, the foreigner disguised as a Uyghur or a Tibetan clearly refers to the wife of the American couple, right? Who is half black and half Native American. So he's misrecognized or misidentified by certain Chinese witnesses as either a Uyghur or Tibetan. Now, in other words, here, Alex Kuo is suggesting, you know, on a very superficial level, he's suggesting a visual resemblance, right, between, you know, Native/Black Americans with Uyghurs and Tibetans in China. And Uyghurs and Tibetans, of course, you know, we know that they all have their own autonomous regions in China and in Xinjiang and Tibet, respectively. And we know that these two places have traditionally caused the most trouble, right, for the stability of the Chinese nation as a whole. So here is in a very offhanded way, right? So Alex Ho is suggesting, you know, behind this visual resemblance, there is something deeper. There are perhaps more essential and more important connections between Tibetans and Uyghurs and the racial minorities here in America, including Native Americans. So this is sort of an offhanded way, but this is an example of double writing, right? So a kind of loose association is drawn between, you know, kind of ethnic minorities in China and racial minorities in America. So he makes this kind of association without specifying, you know, without sort of forcing the reader to think about this association in a certain way. So there is much room, right, in his writing. He leaves much room for the readers to ponder those associations and to think about those associations in their own creative way. All right. So then there are more examples from his other novel, Panda Diaries, and there are more examples of what I consider to be double writing. Now, so here, this novel is completely set in China. You know, this chronicles a few events, you know, surrounding this Chinese character called Gi. So his parents, for example, you know, his parents are sent to the countryside during the Cultural Revolution, and he grows up, and his parents die, in fact, during the Cultural Revolution, and he grows up in the midst of this ethnic minority group in China called the Aurukans. Now, so this is a passage in which the narrator offers a fictionalized account of the early history of the Aurukans. The Aurukans, which, as I was saying, the Aurukans are an ethnic group in the northeastern part of China. Okay, so this is a narrator offering us a fictionalized account of the early history of the Aurukans. Okay, he says this: before that winter was over, the clan, so there's one clan, you know, there's one clan in the Aurukans, the clan was gone, out of sight of bone and eyes, and cursed to live with only what they could carry. They headed north on foot for the mythical Linking Land Bridge, where it was said it would get much colder before it would be warm for them. Their name would then be forever changed to Bayaloop, a word no one would ever pronounce correctly thereafter in any language. Now, I believe that Bayaloop is a play on the word Puyallup, which of course is a name for a native tribe in the state of Washington. So you know, and we know that, you know, Kuo of course was teaching for, or has been living in the state of Washington for a very long time. So what he is suggesting is something, you know, this passage really resonates with the passage from Karen Yamashita that I show in the beginning of the talk, right? So she also suggests that, you know, there is this kind of historical genealogical connection between Native Americans and Asians. And here Alex Kuo is saying something very similar, right? So they crossed the land bridge, right? Native Americans first came to, they first became Native Americans, the Indians first became Indians by crossing this land bridge. And there are more interesting examples in other parts of the book. Now, and here, on two consecutive pages, Alex Kuo offers two sort of unrelated passages, two unrelated paragraphs, which are not connected by any narrative at all. As I was saying earlier, right, he often deliberately disrupts his own narrative by throwing in various odd bits and pieces. So here, in the midst of this narrative about Guy's life, growing up among the Oricans, in the midst of this narrative, he throws in two seemingly unconnected passages on two consecutive pages. So let's look at the first paragraph here. The Oricans now number fewer than 500. They're all leaders or former leaders, but most of them are widows of former leaders. So this is one way of thinking about the dwindling or the decimation, right? The decimation of the Oricans. So the number has dwindled to 500. And the second passage here, on the next page, right? It says this: there are now more than 10,000 Oricans. Since the government started helping them in 1951, six have graduated from college, 64 from technical schools, and more than 200 from high school. Some of them have become teachers and government officials. And every year, Orican singers, dancers, and storytellers travel to Beijing in October to perform in the National Day celebrations at Tiananmen Square in front of Premier Li and state television cameras. So, I mean, this, the tone of the second passage is obviously celebratory and self-congratulatory, right? So this is a passage that imitates the official line on the situation of the Oricans, right? How the government policies have fostered the flourishing, the renaissance of Orican culture, and so the he simply throws these two passages in to show us perhaps the falsity of this the propagandistic language right in the second paragraph. So perhaps the real situation, the reality for the Oricans on the ground is not nearly as bright and happy as the official stats might lead us to believe, right? So this is kind of the juxtaposition of these two paragraphs is a way of creating irony, creating tension to sort of throw these exaggerated claims into question, right? So this is really, quotes a critique of the official sort of ethnic policy in contemporary China, which claims to have protected and preserved ethnic cultures, but the reality might be quite different. Now, and then in a different part of the novel, Alex Kuo very abruptly shifts focus moves to a completely different context, which is the 19th century U.S. So here again, on two consecutive pages, he offers us an account of the social consequences of the 19th century, the American, the westward movement, right, in 19th century America, and how this movement affected the livelihoods of Native American of Indian tribes. So here, this passage from page 30. 2 years before Custer finally got his, and this is a reference to George Armstrong Custer, right? A U.S. Army officer who played a very important role in the Indian Wars. Okay, so 2 years before Custer finally got his, just before the nation's 100th birthday at the Battle of Little Bighorn, 1876. At the Battle of Little Bighorn that was to change the colonial native narrative forever, his boss, General Phil Sheridan, tried to coax the Texas legislature into creating a fellowship program to reward those hunters aiming to obliterate the Plains Indians' bison commissary. So here, you know, there's this cursory reference to, you know, to what happened to the Plains Indians in 19th century America. And then later on, just on the next page, and Quarles points out that this incident, right, the Battle of Little Bighorn, and also the obliteration of the Plains Indians, sort of, you know, their source of food, is a precursor to the 19th century sort of logic of the Cold War, like us versus them, you know, the kind of the imposition of a certain ideology on an entire nation, right? So he is saying that, you know, the expansion, right, the westward expansion, it really proceeded under a very rigid ideology, an ideology which believes in the right to kill everything in this way to make way for modernity, right, for modernization. So here, what we see here is that, you know, at various points of the book, at the novel, sort of, you know, Alex Quarles offers us, it gives us brief references to different snippets from both American history and Chinese history, and so you get a sense of the loose connections between completely different contexts, and you start to see perhaps that, you know, there is some connection between the 19th century you know, sort of process of UX expansion and the nation building project that occurred that went on in contemporary China, right, since 1949. Perhaps you know, both movements, both processes have something to do with globalization, with the proliferation of the nation state form, the nation form around the globe, right? Perhaps both processes have something to do with internal colonization, with the imperative of national integration, with the sacrificing of minority and racial and ethnic cultures. So here again, you know, we are led to think about those connections, those issues in a completely open-ended way. Okay, so before I move on to my second writer, I just wanted to sort of take a detour into a more sociological sort of discussion of ethnic policies in contemporary America and China, because what Quarles is obviously doing is that he's putting pressure, right? He's putting critical pressure on the assumed success of multiculturalisms in the two countries. He's pointing out, you know, a long history of colonization and racial inequality that lie behind the surface, right? The surface of ethnic harmony in both nations in the current moment. So to fully understand what Quarles is critiquing, right? So what he is putting pressure on, we have to have some sense of the state of ethnic policy in both the U.S. and China. And I believe that both nations have a version of multiculturalism. But you know, perhaps you can say that America has liberal multiculturalism, And China has a version of state-sponsored or state-centered or official multiculturalism, but you know, they have certain overlaps and connections. Now let me just sort of very quickly go through this. You know, China has a system of ethnic regional autonomy. In other words, you know, sort of, there are 55 sort of state-recognized ethnic minority groups, in addition to the Han Chinese, right? To the main ethnic group in China. But there are 55 ethnic minority groups in China, and many of them have their own autonomous regions and prefectures and counties. So here on the right hand, what you see here is a recent set of data, stats from 2009. By the end of 2003, China had established 155 ethnic autonomous areas, right, and regions, you know, prefectures, and counties, and banners. Okay, so this is the right-hand side. And the left-hand side, you know, the Chinese states recognize 55 minority nationalities, and their number accounting for perhaps less than 10% of the national population. Right, okay, so that's here. And minority rights in China. So what it means to have autonomy or to have regional autonomy, what does autonomy mean for ethnic minorities in China? So here what you see is, you know, from the Constitution of 1984, it it stipulates or it provides for certain rights for ethnic minorities, including self-government rights, special representation rights in the legislature or bureaucracy, and accommodation rights, including legal recognition to particular customs and practices. So there are a number of preferential policies in China that are designed to help ethnic minorities to have an equal footing in Chinese society, to preserve and foster their own cultures. So, what Alex Kuo is precisely telling us to do is not to completely buy into official rhetoric and official policies, and there is a very wide gulf between what policy looks like and how things really work on the ground, right, for ethnic minorities. And there are many limitations and many problems perhaps hidden beneath those policies that those writers are allowing us to see, writers like Kuo are allowing us to see. Now, turning to the American context, Native American self-determination, right? So this concept, in fact, is not, has a history. It first emerged in important ways in the 1930s, in the early 1940s, during the era of the New Deal. So in fact, the 1940s is also referred to as the Indian New Deal, because this is the period when self-determination for Indians emerged as an important guideline, important a center for the national Indian policy, but then this idea diminished and was sort of countered and vanquished by other notions about other notions of the Indian policy, and they reemerged, right? So this idea reemerged in the 1970s, right? So in the 1970s, of course, is an era of intense Indian protests, but also a decade of important legislation and that works to secure sort of self-determination, the Native American right to self-determination. So the important piece of this legislation, 1975 Indian Self-Determination and Education Assistance Act, which marks in an era in which we have a renaissance, right? Resurgence of the idea of self-determination, and here is just an excerpt taken from the website of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, telling us how many federally recognized tribes we have today. And again, what we see here is again perhaps a tension between official rhetoric and policies, and what actually the problems that Native Americans continue to face in this country, right? So there are still Native American tribes that are not fully recognized by either the federal government or by state governments, and there is urbanization of Native American populations. Native Americans today live in big cities, right? So they might not have access to very traditional services available on reservations and all that. So there are problems that can be masked and obscured, right, by official lines on policies. So this is a very quick survey, and I don't want to dwell on that, but I'm just saying that the virtue of reading literature and the virtue of literary writings perhaps is, right, is allows us to look beyond, think beyond certain types of rhetoric. All right, so the second writer, Wuwu, he's in fact Chinese, and so that's why it takes some thinking to relate him to Alex Kuo, because he is Chinese, and he is in fact a part of the Yi ethnicity or the Yi nationality in China, and he grew up bilingual, and so he started creating sort of bilingual writings in the 1980s and has produced much poetry and prose works since then. And so he's just like Alex Kuo, he's sort of a poet scholar. But he visited, he paid in quite a number of visits to the U.S. in the 2000s, in 2005, 2008, 2009, and he visited a number of U.S. universities. And so he started writing poetry about his American observations, about, you know, American, contemporary American culture, including Native American history and their culture. So he came out with a collection of poems in 2008. So he published a collection of his poems in 2008, and which is titled "The Appeal of the Mississippi River." And this collection includes many poems about many of his Indian poems or Native American poems. All right. And the examples I'm going to give you, they're all from, you know, from this collection, the Appeal of the Mississippi River. But this is something something more overarching, right? And this is from an interview, from a critical essay that a Chinese scholar wrote about Wuwu. So in this essay, this critic relates an interview that Wuwu gave in 2009. And in this interview, and this is what Wuwu says in this interview, he says, "Out of gratitude and the spirit of reciprocity," he said in an interview he gave in 2009, "I started writing about my first anthropological poems based on American history during my U.S. visits and published them as The Appeal of the Mississippi River in 2008. So he describes his relationship to Native Americans as a relationship of reciprocity, mutual respect, and mutual empathy. All right. Now let's look at Indian references in Wuwu, right? Specific references to Indian reservations and the cultural sites include the Adams County Paleo Indian Archaeological District in Ohio, the Fort Hall Reservation in southeastern Idaho, and the Umatilla Indian Reservation in northeast Oregon and southeast Washington. And he doesn't really list those places for the reader. You just have to surmise from his poems what references he is making. Okay, so now the first poem is that this is, you know, he wrote those poems in Chinese, but I translated them into English for you. And do you read Chinese? Any of you? Okay, good. Maybe I'm not going to read this aloud, so you can just, you know, take a look at what the poem looks like roughly. But you know, this is not the complete poem. These are just selected stanzas from the poem. Okay, so this is my translation of those stanzas from this poem, right? Discrimination of verb. Okay, so this is what he says, what Wuwu says in the poem. "Growing in the painting, this tree has never had half a leaf, a purely naked tree, but there are fruits on it, a cluster of black children unclad. These are indeed restless fruits with no roots, but there are also monkeys who steal the fruits. Plant trees." Now, this is quite mysterious, so you don't really know what he is trying to say. We know that there is an image of a tree in a painting, which is a very strangely stripped-down tree with no leaves, with no signs of life to it, except for those strange fruits, right? Those strange kind of rootless, inorganic-looking fruits. Those fruits that look like black children, but also monkeys who take away life from this tree. So I mean, this poem seems a little illogical, and you know, it takes some time to parse it, and I don't guarantee that I have a very good reading of it. But one possible way of thinking about this is to say that this tree is perhaps a sign or a metaphor for the flourishing, right, at least on the surface, the flourishing of ethnic cultures. So if you think about, you know, this tree as a sign of the current state of ethnic cultures in China, or perhaps in the U.S. too. I mean, it's unclear what he is saying, but here, this flourishing or this prosperity seems a little false, right? There is a kind of false prosperity. There is a, you know, kind of a facade of flourishing to ethnic cultures in both of these nations. That's why this tree seems to bear fruits, but those fruits are so artificial and so sort of inorganic, so disconnected from everything else on this tree, that you know, you might very well see those fruits as sort of artificially staged sort of images of ethnic harmony and sort of ethnic ethnic or the flourishing of ethnic cultures, right? So what this poem seems to be saying is that because multiculturalism, right? Multiculturalism, the rhetoric of multiculturalism and the policies of multiculturalism in both of those nations perhaps create a picture of a false picture of ethnic ethnic renaissance or ethnic prosperity, and so this false image in fact masks. Right, masks the lingering issues and problems facing those minority groups, and so this mask in fact can serve not to foster ethnic cultures but smother those cultures because this mask obscures the real problems lying beneath, right? Obscures the real issues and problems lying beneath. So those fruits, they're not really fruits. They're monkeys who make it impossible for this tree to bear organic fruits or bear fruits in an organic manner, right? And of course, also this image of black children is striking. And of course, black and by black, I believe the poet is not specifically referring to blacks or African Americans. He is simply kind of referring broadly and vaguely to a range of peoples of color, or just kind of minority groups. In both nations, and I would say that black has a very the color black has some certain cultural significance in the E context as well, right? We know that the author, the poet here, is of E ethnicity. He has a dual heritage, and here black has a certain kind of importance in the E culture as well. Black and white, these are two contrasting colors in the E culture, and black signifies a certain higher position in the social hierarchy in the E culture, and white, the color white, is in fact the inferior color. So the E culture has sort of a counterintuitive understanding of white and black, which is sort of counter to what the West normally thinks about these two colors. But in any case, right? So the invocation of the color black is an example of double writing for me, right? So here, the white, the color, the word black condenses many different associations and meanings, right? Meanings and associations attached to this word, attached to this symbol, in different national contexts. So he condenses them, he puts them all together, right? Sort of brings them all together with this very striking image. As a way of saying that there is hierarchy, there are power differentials, and there are kind of inequalities in both those nations, in both of these contexts, within each individual, right, ethnic group, and that's why we cannot understand it. We cannot approach or understand discrimination statically, right? Discrimination is not a static it's not a state, stable state of affairs. In fact, discrimination is a verb. It changes and shifts, right? And it takes on different forms in different contexts, right? So the best way of combating discrimination is by taking, an active stance. Is by understanding different contexts in different ways, and also by taking sort of concrete and substantive actions to offer a genuinely a genuinely conducive environment for the growth, right, for the expansion, for the growth and revival of minor cultures and minority cultures. And so plant trees, right? So if discrimination is a verb, then our tactic for combating discrimination must be flexible, right? It must be organic, it must be flexible. flexible must be a word as well. So that's why planting trees, right? Planting trees, meaning getting in touch, right? I mean, it has different, you know, different connotations, right? Meaning it could mean getting in touch with different environments, right? So if you want to plant a tree, you have to understand the local soil, right? So you have to understand the differences between different cultural and national contexts in order to, in fact, plant trees in order to plan effective actions for the revival, for the, you know, renaissance of certain submerged and destroyed cultures. Okay. The second poem, Restoration. This is the Chinese. I'm not going to read this. This is the English. I hope you can still see the words. These are pretty small. Okay, so this is the poem Restoration. Again, this is not the complete poem, it's only excerpts from it. The Banach believe that if the young callously disobey the will of family ancestor, their spirits can put them to death at any time. Last night, I had a strange dream where a blanket of snow falls on Oregon, mixed with heavy firestones that strike me to the ground before the snow slowly covers me up. So the poet is having a dream. In the dream, there's snow, and he's struck down by firestones and covered up by the snow. Right there and then, I hear a voice saying this: quick, use the stones to build a stone house and lie down in it. That's how you can revive yourself. I protest, no, it should be a wooden house. And then through the fissures between the stones, so he does end up building a stone house in accordance with what this voice is telling him, right? So he builds a stone house, and then through the fissures between the stones enter, like a mystery, numerous rays of light as thin as golden thread, fishing my soul slowly out of the stone house. I look down and see my body lie there still. Around it, the firestones begin to burn. I ask eagerly, what about my body? The voice grows impatient. This is revival, not restoration. I woke up in the morning and found one of the gifts from my Indian friends missing, and I believe that my ancestors paid a visit to Oregon last night. This is a slightly confusing poem. I mean, this is about, you know, the poem visiting the Banach reservation and hearing them, you know, tell their own stories and their myths. And he believes that there is this saying among the Banach that disobeying or betraying your own ancestral culture then, you know, so incurs the a wrath of your ancestors, and you get killed. So he is, and the poet is clearly afflicted by the sense of guilt, right? Or his own sense of guilt vis-a-vis his own ethnic heritage is triggered by this Banach myth, by this Banach legend, and he has a dream about being punished, right? Being punished by an invisible hand, by an invisible force, and this force sort of, you know, asks him, or, you know, gives the, commands him to build a stone house, so as a way of saving himself and reviving himself. And of course, you know, he is essentially the poet is asked to, you know, to pick up and to practice again, sort of the traditional craft of building, right, a stone house. The poet is asked to remake himself into a tribesman, right? Remake himself into a more authentic, you know, Yi person, he's asked to find and sort of bring out his Yi self, right? So only by doing that can he be saved. So this is how he sort of atones for his own betrayal in his dream, and then he is saved by this invisible voice, by the ancestral spirits, right, talking to him. And but what's interesting, right, in this process, in this dream of atonement, right, we can see this as a dream of atonement, a dream of repent in this case. But what's interesting is that this dream itself entails an act of a form of betrayal, right, of a sort, because in his dream he really can't tell the identity of the voice talking to him, right? So the voice seems to be telling him to build a stone house, which is not really you know, familiar or a traditional, the traditional type of abode that you associate with the Yi, you know, they are more familiar perhaps with the wooden houses. Stone houses might be, a kind of a cultural symbol, a cultural image that he borrows from other places, including from the Banach, right? He might have borrowed this image from the Banach. So here, in the very dream of atonement, right, the very dream in which the poet atones for his, you know, for his betrayal of his own culture, entails this moment of cultural hybridization. So there is a kind of a deep irony at the heart of this poem, right? So this poem is about the poet searching for cultural authenticity, cultural purity, right? Returning to roots, returning to his own ethnic origin. So this is what the poem is about, and yet at the center, at the core of this poem is a moment of cultural hybridization and cross fertilization and sort of, you know, cultural mixing, right? So this is a poem about, you know, the poet searching for purity and authenticity, and yet he attains this goal. He gets there only through a moment of cultural mixing. So this is the kind of irony that the poet is highly aware of himself, and that's why he points out this irony to the reader essentially toward the end of the poem when he says, you know, this voice tells me that this is revival, not restoration. In other words, ethnic revival doesn't mean reverting to an origin, right? A fixed origin doesn't mean reverting to a state of purity and authenticity. It's really about reshaping and remaking the culture in the contemporary moment in connection with, in relation to many other cultures in the world, including other similar sort of ethnic cultures in other parts of the world. So there is this an awareness in this poem for awareness, or this kind of the poet is starting to realize, right, the importance of placing, right, placing the history of a specific ethnic community within not only a national context but a global, right, comparative transnational context. Only with this kind of perspective can we get a better handle on the status of an individual people, individual culture, and only with this kind of perspective can we reach the goal of revival, right? Ethnic revival, ethnic renaissance. Okay, so this the importance, right? The poet is placing much importance on the practice of cultural hybridization, right? Cultural mixing. And in fact, in this next poem, Miscegenation, I'm not, you know, even offering the Chinese version, but this is simply my translation of it. So in fact, in the poem makes it even more clear in this poem that miscegenation, or sort of cultural mixing and biological mixing too, can be seen as an overarching tactic that many ethnic and racial groups can use for survival, right? For effecting a kind of, you know, revival or survival. Okay, so let me just read this poem for you. I think this is the complete poem. It's not, these are not excerpts. All right. Okay, the poet says this: just as we can't tell whether winter or summer comes first, we don't know if miscegenation is mankind's ultimate solution. The ancient Norse, which is a branch of the Yi, right? So the poet descends, in fact, from... he's part of the Norse branch of the Yi ethnicity. Okay, so he's, you know, referring to his own cultural heritage. The ancient Norse were not ashamed of miscegenation because in their history they had much earlier completed the journey to blood mixing. Ancient Indians, while being conquered and resisting conquest, quietly carried out miscegenation with conquerors. Miscegenation is not simply possession. Miscegenation is not about winning or losing. Blood mixing is the workings of natural forces. against the unnatural growth of certain peoples so that they don't overgrow. But miscegenation can be used as a weapon of life. Now, what this poet seems to be saying is that, you know, miscegenation clearly, you know, is an inevitable product, inevitable consequence of violent encounters, right, between different peoples. Violent encounters that often take the form of colonization. So the poet is saying that, you know, Native Americans as well as ethnic minorities in China, they don't have to be seen as simply victims, right, in this process of colonization, in various moments of violent cultural encounters, right? So they are not simply victims of this forced miscegenation, even though historically they are decimated and their numbers dwindle and their cultures destroyed, the communities dismantled. Yes, with all, you know, these are all true, and yet still, there are hope. There is hope for an act for a form of anti-colonization, right? For a kind of counter-colonization. So what this poet is saying is that perhaps minorities can take this process of cultural transformation into their own hands. They can play a more active role in adapting and transforming and changing traditional tribal cultures in the contemporary era. You know, they can, you know, I mean, tribal cultures can be easily appropriated or contaminated and sort of, you know, commercialized, right, in the contemporary era of capitalist globalization. And yes, that's all true. But the poet says that there are still possibilities for creative remaking of tribal and ethnic cultures that resist the forces of commercialization and white appropriations. So minorities, rather than lamenting the destruction of their cultures and passively, languishing, right, in this process, they can take a more active role in recreating and remaking tribal cultures in the contemporary era. Now, this poem is very much in the same spirit as, for example, Gerald Bisnor, right? Gerald Bisnor, who's sort of a Native American writer as well as theorist, right? His notion of survivance. You know, he has this idea of survivance, which he differentiates from survival. Right? Survival is passive, right? So it's about, you know, waiting to be rescued, waiting to be protected, waiting for policies and government services to help you. And survivance is, has a more active connotation to it, right? It's about, you know, projecting an active presence for the minorities. It's about minorities taking things into their own hands, taking the process of cultural transformation into their own hands and projecting a more active presence on this, in the cultural sphere. In the general cultural sphere, on different scales, and in different national contexts. So here you see some resonance. You hear some resonance, right, between, you know, Aku's notion of miscegenation and Visnor's idea of survivance. So the point, right, the sort of the larger point that I'm trying to make today is precisely that we can see how Chinese American writings, right, or transnational Chinese writings start to imagine ways of constructing a global context, right, for the issues of racial and ethnic inequality, for the issue of sort of, you know, national integration, national expansion, for the issue of the colonization of ethnic peoples as well as cultures. So those writers are starting to imagine and think about those issues as global issues, right, which play out in different ways in different contexts. So that's why the solutions to these issues cannot be confined to a very specific locale. In other words, we can't think of those issues. We can't think of, you know, kind of individual and scattered and disparate issues in isolation. We have to connect them all together and think about them in an integrated way, in order to find holistic solutions, right? Sort of, you know, kind of a global solutions to those problems. In other words, those problems can never be solved in isolated locales, right? So these are global issues, then the solutions that we find for them have to be engineered, have to be created on a global scale as well through the collaborations and interactions among you know, different ethnic communities and groups scattered across the globe, right? So this is, you know, so this is the main sort of message that those writers imply in their writings, and I'm trying to argue for in a more explicit way. All right, so that's my main point that I'm trying to make. However, I'm going to conclude my talk with a poem by your professor here. So this is Russ's poem, Western River, which he wrote very recently, right, on the New Year's Eve, just a couple of months ago. Okay, so this is the poem. Let me read it for you. Winter day, a wash of moving water, dark ribbon wind winds its way through concrete miles. The LA River is not a river, but a release of acid rain and dark spill where seagulls wade in the shallows of the gully. Thousand wide bellies turned in one direction toward the sun glinting on the metal barriers that prevent me from falling. I paddle wheeling my brown shadow, a Tonga man, a Chinese man, forage just above the line of moving water, below what is still hidden in the desert sky. In our hands, we simply carry the spirit of the day, ancient air in the empty clay jar into the new year. I'm sure you've caught the reference here, right? A Tonga man, a Chinese man. So the poet is sort of describing himself not only as a Chinese man, not only as an American man, a Chinese man, but also as a Tonga man. And the Tonga, of course, they refer to a state recognized Native American tribe, right, in California. It's not a federally recognized tribe, but is recognized by the California state. And in fact, you know, the traditional territory is considered to coincide with, more or less, with the boundaries of modern day California, right? So California used to be the Tonga's territory. They used to be they used to live there. And so here, of course, this is the poem that imagines, right? Imagines LA as a very layered structure, right? You know, it has layers and layers of history associated with Chinese Americans, with the Tonga, with the other ethnicities in this place. So that's why we can, you know, kind of flatten out, right, the history of LA and associate it only with one part of its history or one part of its population. California and also more specifically LA belongs to everyone. Right, so that's why everyone walking the streets and paddling, you know, along the LA River, everyone is simultaneously everyone else. Right, so this is sort of, you know, the part of the poem's message, and of course. This poem, I believe, that even though it starts with a pretty bleak image of ecological disasters in LA and, you know, environmental issues in this place, and yet it sort of ends on a happy and hopeful, not happy, but a hopeful note. The image here, the white-bellied sort of sea eagles, right? So they are, of course, traditionally associated with the Tonga as well. So they are signs of life, right? Signs of the possibilities of giving a new lease of life on tribal and traditional ethnic cultures, right? So that's sort of, I guess, maybe Russ, you can jump in and say more about the poem if you want. Anything I have missed or anything you would like to? Oh, you don't have to, but
No, I think you know more about it than I do.
Okay, well, thanks. I believe that this is just a good way of concluding the talk, but also finding a more contemporary kind of parallel to the writers that I thought about. Okay, so that's about it, and just a final plug-in for my own book. Sorry about that, but my pluralist universalism is coming out at the end of April. It includes a section on Alex Kuo, but has other things as well. It's more extended comparative study of two different kinds of multiculturalism, right, in the contemporary era.